All right, so we start by setting power on L1. On L1 and L2 is going to send power on 1 and N. If you have a 120 volt circuit, L2 will be changed to N. In this case, we're going to use a 208 circuit. That's the one we're going to see most commonly. So we're going to power up terminal 1. Okay, this is going to be a straight shot. It's either going to come from your power on the breaker, or if you have your coil wired through your condensing unit, you're going to take power from there. So wherever we get a dedicated 208, okay? As soon as we get power on there, it's going to send power up to the timer motor. Okay, as soon as this timer motor gets power, the time clock should start advancing. So obviously if you have power there and you mark your time clock and you start doing your troubleshooting, you mark it with a Sharpie, 15 minutes later the thing hasn't moved, or 20 minutes later, so it's more noticeable. It hasn't moved, well, you know the problem right there. Okay, next we have a jumper on terminal 2 to terminal 1. So these are jumpered together. Okay, and then we're sending power up to here. And this is a normally open switch, or normally closed switch. The arm will go open and close. Sometimes it's drawn with the contacts, normally closed. So come through here, we come to 4. Okay, whenever 4 has power, 3 will be normally open. So we can see it right here. 3 is normally open. This one's drawn with the arm as well. Normally you'll see it drawn with the other orientation with the normally open and normally closed contacts. Okay, so right now 3 is open. Okay, 3 and 4 will never be closed or open at the same time. Okay, at this point 4 is going to send power down to our evaporator fans. So now terminal 4 is hot. N is obviously going to be hot all the time as long as we have power coming in. So we can draw N here in the circuit. So right now in this setup, 4 and N are hot. They're red and blue. So if you tested across 4 and N, you would get 208 at this point. All right, at this point, terminal 4 would send power to the red side, or the L1 leg of the fan motors. They're all jumpered together, as you can see them. They jumper through here. Okay. And then our L2 side is coming from N. So we come off of N onto our red wire. So this is like a universal switch that all the manufacturers use. You don't need this specific one for the coil. Sometimes you want the specific one just because of how it mounts to the coil. But if you're in a pinch, a lot of these are universal. They use all the same color code, red, brown, and black. So at this point, N would send power to terminal C. Okay? So if the coil is below 35 Fahrenheit, this switch here is closed. Okay? If it's above 35, the switch will be open. Okay, why that's important, your fans don't turn on until the coil gets to 35 Fahrenheit. Okay, so we're below 35, and if you go to a call and the coil's below 35, it's freezing and the fans aren't turning on. Okay, you want to check for power between 4 and F first. If we don't have power at 4 and F, you start working backwards, okay, and see why F is not getting power. It's probably this switch has failed. Okay. So in this orientation here, our fans working. All our evaporator fans are working. The switch is on the red to black position. 4 and F get power. Okay. Now when we go into a defrost, the first thing that's going to happen on a defrost is the normally closed switched up here that we're talking about, this arm is actually going to open. So as soon as a defrost starts, okay, so you can set those pins. Usually it's every 6 hours. We'll set it anywhere from half an hour to 1 hour. Usually we'll set it to 1 hour. This arm here is now going to actually open up like this. And pin one is now going to come here, and it's going to close this arm right here. So they've drawn this arm kind of poorly, but this arm here is now going to close. So we now have power on pin three. Okay, so this normally open contact now becomes normally closed as soon as we hit that defrost pin on the timer. We're going to come through three. All right, we're gonna feed the bottom here. We're gonna go right to terminal three. So right now, three and N are the only ones that should be hot, okay? The fans will no longer be working because we've lost power on four. Why we don't want the fans to run during defrost? So obviously there's steam and there's moisture. We don't want that all going on the ceiling. So we don't want to push all the steam and moisture onto the ceiling. And then when the cooler freezes, then you get all the droplets of steam on the ceiling. And then once they defrost, they go all over the floor. And it might not seem like much, but over time, it will collect. All right, so right now, N and 3 are hot. So if we continue to draw through our N, we come through here. We're going to come through our heater limit switch. So all this switch is, just say one of the, if anything gets stuck, closed, and the heaters always get power. We obviously don't want the heaters on when we have the compressor on. So we have a heater limit switch that will open up, and it'll turn off the heaters for us. This is going to come up through here. And we're going to feed our H1. So now our H1 is hot. And if we look at our H2, it's wired directly into N. And as we know, N is our L2, so we always have power on here as long as we have power up top. So now our H1 and H2, the defrost heaters would turn on. Defrost clock I usually set to 1 hour, okay? So what happens now in that 1 hour is now the coil has gotten above 35 Fahrenheit, so this switch is no longer going to be closed. And now we use the second side of the switch. So what happens on this second side of the switch? All right, so we're going to come to defrost termination switch. Okay. Once we get to 55 Fahrenheit, so that is most likely going to happen before our 1 hour's up. If we have a good coil that's not collecting a lot of ice, if we're collecting a lot of ice, and we're going the full cycle, the full 1 hour, that's telling us we probably have an issue. Either a drain or something's freezing up. There's too much ice or frost on the coil. It could be a TXV adjustment. There's all kinds of reasons why. So once we get to 55 Fahrenheit, we're going to close this switch. Okay. So this is our brown wire. Brown's going to X. Okay. X is going up to X on our defrost clock. Okay. So right here, we show a load here. So this guy right here is actually a solenoid. Okay, so that's a solenoid. Okay, so because pin three is hot as well still, pin three comes over to here. Okay, so as soon as X gets power and three should be sending power to at all times, this solenoid activates. What this solenoid does is it activates a plunger. Okay, as soon as the plunger goes up, and you'll hear it click. Okay, as soon as the plunger goes up, it will remove power from three and put it back onto four. Okay, why we want this to happen is what I was talking about earlier. We don't want too much steam in the box. So if once we get above 55, that's what we found is the number 55 coil temperature, not box temperature. Once we get to that number, we're creating a lot of steam in that box. And as soon as we get water droplets on the ceiling and they freeze, and then once we go back into defrost, it'll leak all over the floor. Okay, and it adds up over time. If you do it over a couple days or even over a couple, even a week is enough for it to be noticeable on the floor. Obviously, once we have water on the floor, it's going to freeze up. We don't have any defrost elements under the floor, so it literally becomes a slip and fall hazard. As soon as this solenoid's activated, we're going to lose power on 3. Okay. And then 2 is going to jumper the power back up to 4. This arm's going to be closed again because our solenoid activated and activated that plunger. Now that we lost power on 3, the solenoid's no longer in the circuit. And then 4 comes back down and it's going to feed this whole circuit again. If we have power on terminal X here, okay, you can never be in a defrost. So if you're ever using a defrost clock, and as soon as you put it into defrost, right away it's going back into cooling. A lot of people think, hey, the problem's with the defrost clock. But in fact, you have to come and take a look at this X terminal. Okay, because as soon as we have power on this X terminal, we're going to have power up here on this solenoid. This is a pretty common problem you're going to see. Is sometimes this arm gets stuck up here. And I've seen that happen a lot. And I've seen it get stuck both ways, actually, up and down. Okay. But when the arm gets stuck up here, what happens is it thinks the coil's 55 Fahrenheit and it'll never go into a defrost. Okay, so if you go and you have a clock, and even you'll see it on the true timers, they have the green light, red light. If you go into defrost, it goes to red light for 1 second, it clicks off. The first thing I'm going to is this switch. Okay, if there's power on X, we have power on the solenoid. Anytime there's power on the solenoid, the plunger kicks up. It takes 3 out. It kicks this arm out. It closes this arm right here. Now we're going to wire in a digital thermostat. Okay, so this one's a little bit funny. The schematic doesn't really add up to what they have in the booklet. And I'll show you why. So first thing you want to do is L. Okay, that's going to go to terminal 1 right here. Okay, we're going to jumper that in there. We're going to send a wire from terminal 1. Okay, now whether you have a 208 or 120 volt unit. Okay, so we're going to stick with our 208. We're going to come from here and we're going to go right on N. So that means we always have power at the thermostat. Okay. How they've drawn it here is they want you to take power from terminal 4. Okay, you can't take power from terminal 4 because as soon as the defrost clock's activated, terminal 4 will lose power and you'll lose your digital display. Okay, so we're not going to use this jumper wire. So what we're going to do is from LC, we're going to take this, we're going to go to terminal 4. Okay, so that means the only time the actual contacts, okay? So this side here is for power in for the display. The only time the contacts have power is when we're not in a defrost, okay? That's important. We don't want the compressor running during a defrost, obviously. It defeats the purpose, okay? The compressor will keep running, the fans will keep running, and the elements will be on. All right, your L, I know, is gonna come here, and it's gonna tie into your wire 4 right here. So you're not going to connect this wire 4 coming out, okay? And you're going to connect this right into your liquid line solenoid, okay? So now we have power on here when these terminals close. These terminals can only close when we have now. Now, if you're ever in a situation like that where this switch has failed close, if you disconnect this X terminal, the defrost will work, but it will go for the entire duration. So if it's set to 30 minutes or 1 hour, it'll go for that length. So obviously that would be a pretty temporary solution, but at least they would get a defrost and the coil wouldn't be freezing up on them. Second side is liquid line solenoid. is now going to get power off of N. And as we know, N's always powered up. That's your L2. Okay, it's a straight shot. It's coming from wherever you're coming from, either the contactor for the compressor or if we're on separate circuits, it's a straight shot from your power feed.